Hello students, today I have come up with the next part of the chapter atomic structure. So in the last video we have explained that what are cathode rays, and we have established the fact that electrons are the constituent particles of an atom. So we have known that atoms are neutral. Atoms are not charged, they are neutral. So if we have established the fact, if the fact is established that the atom consists of a particle which is negatively charged, that is the electron, then in order to make the atom neutral, there must be some positively charged particles that will neutralize the charge of the electrons. So considering this fact, Goldstein has set up an experiment. So that experiment will also contain the discharge tube. So let's start with that experiment and see what did he observe. This is the positively charged electrode or the anode. This is the vacuum pump. Hydrogen gas at low pressure is introduced inside the discharge tube. Now here the cathode is made in a different way. This is the cathode. The cathode used is perforated, or the cathode used is having holes inside it. So what did he notice? What did Goldstein notice? Goldstein noticed that there are illuminating rays. There are illuminating rays emitting from the anode, and these rays will pass through the holes of the cathode. And these rays passing through the holes of the cathode, they will, okay, before telling this, I just want to say that the other side of the discharge tube is being coated with zinc sulfide. These rays emitted from the anode, they will pass through the holes of the cathode and they will produce fluorescence at the glass wall of the discharge tube. Since these rays were passing through the holes of the cathode, these rays were known as canal rays initially. But later on, since these rays are coming from the anode, they are being given the name anode rays. Okay, so anode rays come like that. Now the anode rays, generally the following are the observations. The anode rays travel in straight lines, and another observation was seen that the anode rays have a speed which is much less than the cathode rays. These anode rays are positively charged, like the experiment J.J. Thomson has done, that he has introduced an electric field around the cathode rays and seen that the cathode rays gets deflected towards the positive plane. The same type of thing was done here. The anode rays were placed in an electric field and it is seen that the anode rays gets deflected towards the negative plate, showing that the anode rays are positively charged particles. The particles that constitute the anode rays, the E by M ratio of the particles is smaller than that of the cathode rays particles. This ratio is smaller than that of the cathode rays. You can see that this is charged by mass. We know that the positively charged particles are present in an atom only to balance the negatively charged electrons. So the positively charged particles should have a positive charge with the same value of that of an electron. So the value of E for the positively charged particles containing the means which constitute the anode rays will be same as the charge of an electron. The charge of an electron should be in negative term and this should be in positive term. But the value of charge, that will remain same. Then why this ratio is smaller than the ratio of the E by M ratio of the electrons? That must be because of the mass of the particles. So if the mass of the particles of the anode rays are greater than the mass of the electron, then obviously this ratio will be smaller. So the mass of positively charged particles is less than that of an electron. The mass of the positively charged particles will be greater than that of an electron. That's why this entire ratio is smaller. Now another thing is important here, that if we are continuously changing the gases inside the discharge tube, or we are changing the anode and the cathode, we can see that the ratio of E by M will vary. The ratio of E by M is not constant here like that it was for the electrons. It will vary. But another positive point is that it will vary like it will be an integral multiple of a fixed E by M ratio. How it will be integral multiple? This n's value can be 1, 2, 3, 4, anything. That's why it is said that an atom also consists of positively charged particles like this. But the fact is that from where does the term proton comes out? From where does the term proton comes out? It is seen that the E by M ratio for the positively charged particles is highest when the hydrogen gas is used in the discharge tube. When hydrogen gas is placed in the discharge tube. So they have considered that the mass of the positively charged particle must be almost similar to the mass of hydrogen gas, mass of an atom of hydrogen. That's why they have said that this charge means this charge is same. No, because earlier only I have told you that the electrons need a positive charge to balance their negative charge, to make the atom neutral. So this value of the charge will remain same. For electron it will be negative value, and for proton it will be just positive value. We have not come to the word proton till now, but you all know that proton is positively charged, that's why I have used it now. But from where does the term proton comes? So it is said that the anode rays with maximum E by M value, the anode rays with maximum E by M value must contain particles which are none other than hydrogen atoms devoid of electrons. Means they said that since this ratio is maximum for hydrogen, then these particles must be such particles, whose E by M ratio will be similar to a hydrogen atom devoid of an electron. What do you mean? That is, hydrogen atom devoid of an electron means H plus. They said that the E by M ratio of that particle should be equal to a hydrogen atom devoid of electron, that is H plus. And from there, these particles are named as protons. We all know that H plus is known as a proton. And these particles, who named these particles as protons? These particles were named as protons by Rutherford. So, here also we will have E by M ratio. Here also we will calculate the charge of a proton. Charge of a proton is plus 1.602 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. And mass of a proton, we can calculate the mass of a proton in the same way the mass of an electron was calculated. So what is the mass of a proton? 1.6725 into 10 to the power minus 24 gram. So the mass of a proton is much greater than the mass of an electron. Or we can say that the proton is 1826 times heavier than electron. The proton is 1826 times heavier than an electron. So this is basically about the discovery of proton. So we have studied the discovery of proton and the discovery of electron. In the next day we will just study the discovery of neutron, and we will then start with the structure of an atom. Okay, so thank you.